Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
In our last podcast, we discussed the factors that influence the risk of progression of isolated RBD to Parkinson's disease or dementia with Lewy bodies. Today, I'd like to consider whether we should tell patients about this risk when currently we have no methods available really to reduce the risk. If we do tell them, what is the best way of relating this information? To answer these questions, my guest today is again Dr. Eric St. Louis, a board-certified neurologist and sleep specialist at Mayo Clinic. So, Eric, let's consider a scenario of a 65-year-old patient with a 2-year history of dream enactment behavior, but no features on history or examination to suggest a neurodegenerative disorder. Polysomnogram confirms increased tone in REM sleep. We have a diagnosis of isolated RBD. Hearing about the risk of this patient developing Parkinson's disease or dementia could be a life-changing experience. What are the ethical principles we should consider in determining whether or not to tell him about it?
Well, Mike, thanks for having me back on the podcast. The single greatest risk for developing Parkinson's disease is a polysomnogram-associated diagnosis of REM sleep behavior disorder, with sleep study cohort studies suggesting that in older adults over 60 to 70 years of age at diagnosis, the conversion rate to define neurodegenerative disease is likely in the broad range of 50 to 80%. Therefore, the discovery of a new RBD diagnosis carries substantial prognostic weight for most older adults. As we discussed in the last episode, we have a lesser degree of prognostic information for younger adults, particularly those under 50 years, who very likely do not harbor the same weighted risk, at least in the near-term period, or let's say a decade out from diagnosis. The consideration of prognostic risk counseling in isolated RBD is therefore a genuine ethical dilemma in which some competing moral principles are at play. There are several ethical principles that apply to the case scenario of an older adult, newly diagnosed RBD patient that you just described, particularly autonomy, non-maleficence, and truth-telling. Truth-telling and respect for autonomy are the overriding ethical principles applying here. Truth-telling would hold that we should openly disclose and therefore not keep hidden any information that the patient needs and deserves to know about their condition. For complete context, there's an older and now largely passé principle of medical paternalism or maternalism, which previously held sway for many practitioners to avoid having a full disclosure of a difficult diagnosis and prognosis. Paternalism is construed as a parental responsibility to the patient to withhold certain information or cares that the provider believes could be harmful to the patient's best interest. And while this is now ethically mostly passé, its practices still hold sway in provider beliefs and practices. The inherent problem with maternalism or paternalism is that it involves provider decision-making on behalf of the patient, without the patient's involvement or knowledge. In contemporary bioethics, the patient's own interest and right toward self-determination as enacted in the principle of autonomy must really be respected above all other competing priorities. The patient's own interest and right for self-determination through the context of information provision and personal capability for understanding and informed decision-making should also be thought about. In other words, the person needs to possess decision-making capacity to have full autonomy, and we're not going to give into the situation here of diminished autonomy. Respect for autonomy has near absolute standing amongst other ethical priorities in contemporary practice. And the patient's autonomy should always be respected by providers and suggests the need for full prognostic disclosure or at least as in terms of what the patient would her or himself want to know about the diagnosis and prognosis. Now, on the other hand, the moral principle of non-maleficence, which is in keeping with our historical Hippocratic ethos of at first doing no harm, may suggest in this situation that the provider should consider avoiding the potential harm of sharing an uncomfortable truth, that the older adult patient with isolated RBD is very likely to have a substantial risk for Parkinsonism or dementia following their diagnosis. Since in current practice, the prognostic trajectory cannot be individualized accurately, and since currently there is no known neuroprotective therapy to make prognostic knowledge actionable, at least directly. So the concern from a non-maleficence perspective is one of avoiding the harm of undue personal anxiety that could be caused by full knowledge of one's prognosis for developing a defined neurodegenerative disorder.
Good. So those are the slightly conflicting principles we work with. So I was very pleased that you've recently completed a real-world study asking patients with RBD about their experiences in having the diagnosis disclosed. What were the results?
Well, we surveyed 81 patients with isolated RBD, who we follow both in our clinical practice and who participate in our Mayo Clinic RBD patient registry, which is a prospective research cohort focused on determining long-term RBD patient outcomes. We asked them about their values and preferences for prognostic risk disclosure, and overwhelmingly, our patients responded that they favored full disclosure of the risk for Parkinsonism or dementia, the most preferred approach being to seek even more information about their diagnosis and prognosis so as to be fully informed. But perhaps a little paradoxically, about half of our patients noted that the level of anxiety increased after hearing of the risk. For those who wanted to take a deeper dive on this data, it was published in last year's edition of Sleep in 2023 in volume 46. A limitation of this study, though, should be noted. And since all respondents were participants in our research registry, and we're in this prospective research cohort focused on outcomes, it's logical to think that there may be a bias toward preferring greater personal knowledge about their condition and prognosis than perhaps the average patient encountered in a community practice. However, lending some further support to the findings that most patients want to know, other similar subsequent surveys have been done internationally and have shown highly similar findings toward the patient preference for full prognostic disclosure in the setting of newly diagnosed RBD.
The other factor, of course, is that with, you know, almost huge numbers of patients are simply going to go and look on the internet for REM sleep behavior disorder once they're told the diagnosis and immediately find out relationships to Parkinson disease. And I think it's much better that we give them a very carefully thought through account of what is the risk and what isn't the risk and all about it, rather than they get incorrect information from the internet. So disclosing the bad news, however, is not easy for any healthcare provider. So considering the ethical principles and your study results, tell us how you personally inform a patient about this risk. What hints can you give providers so they can do this in a realistic but empathetic way?
Well, with respect to the principle of truth-telling and trying to resolve the ethical tension between respecting autonomy and the point of non-maleficence of avoiding undue anxiety, we can use the model of shared decision-making with our patients to understand what their own personal values and preferences may be to determine both whether to disclose and the extent of the discussion. The overriding consideration of respect for autonomy, this is with respect to the patient's own preference for what they may wish to know, should dictate the extent of risk disclosure that's most relevant and individualized to their case. Shared decision-making means we provide directive and suitably comprehensive counseling to our patients to help them make the best informed decision for their future cares, and in this situation of prognostic counseling, information that they can use and find to be personally actionable for planning out their lives. So the older adult, newly diagnosed with isolated RBD scenario, We should initially state that this new RBD diagnosis can represent a risk for developing other neurological disorders in the future, and then pause to ask the patient what further information and in how much detail the patient would want to learn about this association. This can be a lot to do and hear also at a first initial visit when you're just encountering the patient for the first time and trying to establish a trusting doctor-patient relationship. So frequently, if we don't get to it in the first visit, we may have to initiate discussions during the abbreviated time we may have at first. For example, sometimes we meet the patient in a tight visit where we're just talking about sleep study results, and perhaps we didn't even expect RBD and it pops up during the study. In such cases, we really need to continue the discussions longitudinally during the course of subsequent follow-up visits and sometimes serially over longitudinal care over time. And this can be better to kind of balance out the discussions over time so it doesn't become too daunting in the context of an initial visit. Mike, one additional vital consideration about all of this that I really learned from you in our discussions about important issues related to prognosis and RBD is that a very significant concern for our older patients who receive this new diagnosis is they want to know how to approach their, say, retirement planning, their future work life, their personal bucket list plans, and importantly, to begin planning for advanced care directives to outline their preferences at a time they still have full decision-making ability. Our patients will want to reflect upon how and when to plan for important life transitions, such as when they will retire. How will they prioritize making certain trips or journeys or dedicating time to certain life, work, social, and physical activities when they're still within their best optimal personal health span? Sharing information regarding prognosis can really be helpful for our patients as they lay plans for these important life transitions and aspirations.
Right.
I was just going to add, because of the anxiety that may occur in this setting, trying to also openly discuss that or ask how the patient is feeling after receiving the news and making any appropriate either further discussion, arranging time for discussion with them, or potentially even arranging referrals to psychiatry or psychology services for supportive counseling can be a helpful consideration.
Thank you. So finally, tell us about your recommendations for follow-up care. How often should the patient be seen? What do you do at each visit?
Generally, I recommend seeing patients with isolated RBD at least annually. Sometimes it's more often if they're having a severe volume of REM sleep behavior disorder attacks on a regular basis to plan their symptomatic treatment. We may see them every 3 to 6 months. But at the annual visits, we aim to conduct routine clinical interval history, also conducting neurological exams, which can be helpful and informative to individualize the counseling to how things seem to be going along the trajectory for that individual are some of the things that we consider. The importance of longitudinal care in RBD really can't be overstated. At initial visits, when the patient has a paucity of other neurological symptoms or signs, individualizing the prognosis can be quite challenging. And the patient's individual trajectory only often becomes clear during the course of longitudinal follow-up visits, since then we have the ability to assess the pace of any newly evolving neurological symptoms or physical findings of cognitive, motor, or autonomic impairments. And then the information can be further individualized and tailored toward their own individual disease trajectory. I've heard from some of our sleep medicine colleagues around the world, really, who are primarily trained in other non-neurology disciplines, for example, pulmonary medicine, psychiatry, primary care, that they may prefer to refer to or otherwise directly involve a sleep or movement disorders neurologist during their annual follow-up visit. However, if the provider is comfortable with their own knowledge base in neurology and conducting a basic history and exam, then I believe long-term follow-up of RBD patients is well within the practice scope of the general sleep medicine practitioner.
Good. So, what final messages do you have for our listeners?
Well, the bottom line is that prognostic counseling and isolated RBD is still really an evolving art form in sleep medicine practice. We have clear information that our patients with RBD generally want to know as much as possible about their own prognostic risk for developing a defined neurodegenerative disorder in the future. So, initiating the conversation by way of shared decision making should be the approach at our initial visits to determine the patient's own values and preferences regarding what they want to learn about their prognosis. And then continuing this conversation during the course of longitudinal follow-up visits offers some further chances for individualizing the information and tailoring it to the patient. Mike, thanks again, very much for having me on.
Thank you. I'm sure that your advice and wisdom there will be very helpful to our listeners. We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.